Good afternoon. On behalf of the Terry Lectures Committee and Yale University Press, welcome to the second presentation in the 2017 Terry Lectures series entitled The Anatomy of Religion and presented by Professor Anthony Appiah. I am Jean Thompson Black, Senior Executive Editor at Yale University Press and a member of the Terry Committee. The Terry Lectures have been an important part of the life of Yale University since they were endowed in 1905 by Dwight Harrington Terry of Bridgeport, Connecticut. The endowment for the lectures stipulates that they should foster the assimilation and interpretation of that which has been or shall hereafter be discovered and its application to human welfare, especially by the building of the truths of science and philosophy into the structure of a broadened and purified religion. For over a century, the Terry Lectures have attempted to live up to that mandate. Professor Appiah was born and raised in London. He read philosophy at Cambridge University, where he took his BA and PhD degrees. He has had a distinguished academic career and has taught at Cornell, Duke, Harvard, Yale, and Princeton. Presently, he is professor of philosophy and law at New York University. In addition to his work in philosophy, Professor Appiah has made significant contributions to the study of African and African-American literature and culture, including books such as In My Father's House, published 1992, which won the Annisfield Wolf Book Award, as well as the Herskowitz Award of the African Studies Association, and also Lines of Descent, W.E.B. Du Bois, and The Emergency of Identity, published in 2014. Professor Appiah is also known for works such as Thinking It Through, The Ethics of Identity, Cosmopolitanism, Ethics in a World of Strangers, and The Honor Code, How Moral Revolutions Happen. He also began to write in October 2015 the weekly ethicist column for the New York Times Magazine. He is the recipient of many awards and honors, among them membership in the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the American Philosophical Society, and the American Academy of Arts and Letters. Professor Appiah's interests range widely across not just philosophy, but also African and African-American studies and literary studies, ethics, and much more. He is also exploring how we now think about religion. Yesterday, his first lecture, entitled Gods and Spirits, considered the concept of religion and the theory of religion proposed by Edward Tyler, who could be considered the first modern cultural anthropologist. Today's lecture, Churches and Symbols, will consider social forms of religion and what they mean. The third lecture, Religion After Darwin, will not be delivered here. It will be delivered on Tuesday, April 25th at the Whitney Humanities Center. After the lecture, there will be a Q&A session of about 20 minutes. Thereafter, we invite you to join us at a reception in the foyer to the left of this stage. Please join us for conversation and an opportunity to talk further. Before we begin, please turn off all cell phones and noise-making devices. Thank you.
Is this, have I got this right? Have I got it on? Good, great. Thank you very much for that kind introduction. Thank you all for coming. You don't have to turn your phone off, but I'm going to put mine into flight mode. As I say, thank you very much for coming. And yesterday we talked about Tyler, and I want to turn today to Durkheim and Weber and talk about what was added by them to the scientific understanding of religion in the early 20th century. Max Weber practiced no religion. As for belief, if he wasn't an atheist, he might as well have been. His wife wrote that he thought empirical science conflicted with, quote, the decisive religious claim that the world has been created by God and is therefore a cosmos ordered in an ethically meaningful way. Weber paraphrased the formula of the early Christian theologian, Tertullian. Religious intellectuals, Weber wrote, quote, display that absolute surrender expressed in the formula credo quia absurdum est. I believe it because it's absurd. But Weber had been raised by a devout and socially progressive Calvinist mother, and he knew that tradition very much, so to speak, from within. When he published his best-known work, The Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism, in 1904 and 5, he was speaking, unlike Tyler, about traditions that were, in a sense, his own. Still, the book maintains an external perspective, beginning with the sort of sociological observation about religion I described last time, where religious labels provide an independent variable in defining a social pattern. The configuration in question concerns a topic that doesn't sound at first at all thrilling, the occupational statistics of a denominationally mixed region. But this fact had received a great deal of attention, especially among Catholics in Germany, and it was this, and this is how Weber puts it. Business leaders and owners of capital, as well as the higher grades of skilled labor, and even more the higher technically and commercially trained personnel of modern enterprises, are overwhelmingly Protestant. In the pages that follow, Weber moves through a systematic review of a wide range of European societies, Germany, his homeland, but also Poland, Scotland, England, Hungary, Russia, so he can rule out a series of possible hypotheses about why this fact obtains. In the end, however, Weber urges, we will only understand the situation if we think not about what distinguishes the Catholics, whose absence from business first draw our attention, but rather about the characteristics of their Protestant fellow citizens. Not so much then a Catholic surplus, but a lack. And so we arrive at Weber's thesis, there is something about the Protestant ethos that connects with the spirit of capitalism. Weber was a thoughtful, if rather unsystematic, methodologist, and he tells us that in the development of historical concepts, such as this, the spirit of capitalism, we should not begin with a definition. Instead, our grasp of the concept, he said, must be gradually put together out of the individual parts which are taken from historical reality, so that we can produce the best conceptual formulation of what we have understood by the spirit of capitalism, that is the best from the point of view which interests us here, namely a concern with the understanding of human social behavior. Weber's analytical concepts are often complex, and they are also often far from precise. For Weber had internalized, to a very high degree, Aristotle's famous maxim that you should adopt the degree of precision appropriate to the subject. Actually, Aristotle says that an educated person will adopt the degree of precision appropriate to the subject. And social behavior, as he learned from decades of the study of societies around the world, shows many patterns but few sharp boundaries. The text of Economy and Society, his Summa, contains many hedging phrases. Not always, normally, often. So we should understand both the Protestant ethic and the spirit of capitalism as what he came to call ideal types. In one of his methodological essays, he describes that concept as follows. An ideal type is formed by the one-sided accentuation of one or more points of view and by the synthesis of a great many diffuse, discrete, more or less present and occasionally absent concrete individual phenomena, which are arranged according to these one-sidedly emphasized viewpoints into a unified analytical construct. This mental construct cannot be found empirically anywhere in reality. Maybe that doesn't sound too promising. He concludes that we will need to determine in each case the extent to which this ideal construct approximates to or diverges from reality. To develop an ideal type, you must synthesize great quantities of ethnographic and historical material, and its point will be visible only once it emerges through the analysis of that material. So rather than offer a definition here at the start, Weber provides what he calls a provisional illustration of that spirit, an instance of exactly the sort of concrete individual phenomena that he had in mind. The passage he quotes begins, "Remember that time is money. He that can earn 10 shillings a day by his labor and goes abroad or sits idle one half of that day, though he spends but sixpence during his diversion or idleness, It ought not to be reckoned the only expense. He hath really spent or thrown away 5 shillings beside. That is the 5 shillings that he didn't make. There's nothing obviously religious in this extended disquisition, which Weber quotes over a couple of pages. Yet he calls it a little sermon. It comes, as you probably know, from Benjamin Franklin's advice to a young tradesman of 1748. And the key to what Weber calls this philosophy of avarice lies in the idea of a duty of the individual toward the increase of his capital assumed as an end in itself. That's a quotation from Weber. Sorry, it's a translation from Weber. Weber's basic proposal is that what we see here is an expression of a consciousness formed by the sort of Calvinism in which he himself, like Benjamin Franklin, was raised. And he sets out to help us understand it. For this purpose, he needs to draw attention to some central features of Calvinism. He starts with the belief in predestination. God has chosen some individuals for everlasting life, others he has condemned to everlasting death. I said at the start of this lecture that Weber understood Calvinism from the inside. Part of his method, something he shared with other philosophically minded sociologists of his day, was the method of Verstehen, understanding. To make sense of social behavior, we must first see it from the actor's point of view. Notice that Tyler, too, had aimed to make sense of religious life by understanding the psychological states of the religious, though he focused almost exclusively on their ontology, on their beliefs about what sorts of things inhabited the world. In exploring the behavior of the Calvinists, who Weber insisted had created modern capitalism, we needed to understand their inner states, too, but the psychology that Weber draws on here has much more to say about feeling, which I argued was a relatively neglected dimension of Tyler's story. Here is a characteristic and I find moving passage where Weber explores the psychological condition of the Calvinists faced with a predestinarian creed. In all of its fervent inhumanity, this doctrine must have had one consequence above all for the sentiments of a generation that yielded to its sublime consistency, a feeling of unprecedented inner loneliness for each individual. In what was, for the people of the Reformation era, the most crucial issue of their lives, their eternal salvation, a human being was directed to travel his path alone toward a destiny decreed from all eternity. That's the end of the quote. Because your fate was fixed, there was nothing you or anyone else, not a priest, not your prayerful family, could do to change it. And you did not know what it was. Only if your life displayed the marks of election did you have some grounds for hope. All the sacraments, the Eucharist, confession, absolution, that had once promised relief and the return to God's favor after the inevitable errors of a sinful creature, all the hope that came from the possibility that you might be justified by good deeds or saved by faith or the magical power of rituals, all this was gone. Tyler saw in religion a means of shaping your fate in this world and in the later higher religions, the next. For the Calvinist, God, in all his remote magnificence, was absolutely unmovable. In the religion of Tyler's primitives, you could aim to control the gods, even if only by submitting to their absolute authority. Weber's Calvinist, in stark contrast, could not ask for God's favor, since if you were among the elect, he had given it to you freely before you had done anything, and if you were not, he had already condemned you. It might happen, though, that you displayed Christian virtues, and given the notion of a vocation, Luther's idea that you must fulfill the obligations imposed upon you by your position in the world, you could do that in your everyday work. Eternal life was not a reward for virtue, but virtue was a sign of election. And thus, if you happened to find yourself drawn to living a Christian life, you had reason for hope. So you needed to know what virtues in the callings of everyday life were signs of election. The answer, frugality, hard work, conscientiousness, precisely the virtues that Franklin had commended to his young apprentice. Weber underlined one of the many ironies of his account. Luther and Calvin, he said, were not the founders of societies for ethical culture, nor the proponents of humanitarian projects for social reform or cultural ideals. The salvation of the soul, and that alone was the center of their life and work. That's Weber. And they taught that there was nothing you could do to save yourself. Yet those who followed them came to find the signs of election in attributes like thrift, industriousness, and diligence that led, in a capitalist economy, to worldly success. They practiced them not because they would earn them a place in heaven, and not, of course, because they wanted to lay up for themselves treasures upon earth where moth and rust doth corrupt, but because their presence in your life was a sign that you were already guaranteed that place. The practical effect, though, was the same. Calvinists developed the habits and behavior that led to business success. Reading Weber's detailed account of the thinking of these Protestants, whose world he seeks to understand, one does come to feel their response makes a kind of sense, even if there is something profoundly paradoxical about being moved to everyday holiness by the thought that everything is already fixed in advance. But even if Weber was right, there are puzzles that push you back earlier in the story. Why was it particularly those virtues of frugality and hard work that came to be identified with election? Why wasn't it charity or generosity? There's a puzzle, too, as to why it was the predestinarian story that took hold in the first place, replacing the older Catholic picture, which offered so much more obvious consolations. Surely the more familiar human response is wishful thinking. But someone who was convinced that a Christian would follow a vocation and work hard at it would be ideally placed to flourish, as Weber argued, in the world of modern business. Weber's explanation didn't need to say what made these attitudes religious. All that mattered was that he could apply the label Protestant or Calvinist to a group of people and associate them with a commitment to certain values and behavior that flows from those, from what they are. Nor does his account tell us much about other religions. Weber went on, though, to explore religious traditions from around the world, publishing The Religion of China and The Religion of India in 1916, and Ancient Judaism over the next 2 years, 17 and 18. He was engaged in trying to complete the section on religion in his Summer, Economy and Society, when he died in 1920 as one of the tens of millions of victims of the Spanish flu epidemic. That work was published in 1922, and the section on religion is known today in English as The Sociology of Religion. And here he had to face the question, what made all these earlier works studies of the same thing? I mean, these things look very different in these books, so why are they all on the, why are they all the same topic? But just as he had refused to define the spirit of capitalism at the start of the Protestant ethic, Weber wanted the true nature of religion to emerge in the course of the study. Quote, "The essence of religion is absolutely not our concern," he wrote. "Our project, rather, is the investigation of the conditions and effects of a particular type of social behavior." This is, to be sure, a little unhelpful, since in declining to define religion, Weber has left it open which type of social behavior he's interested in. But he has at least given us something to go on, because this definition of the project commits him to the sociology of religion as the study of forms of social behavior. Because Tyler had defined culture as including knowledge and belief, all knowledge and belief acquired as a member of society, he didn't need to attend solely to social behavior. Indeed, much of the religious behavior that Tyler discussed was the result of socially acquired beliefs, but could be practiced on your own. Individuals could seek the assistance of spirits individually. What was social was only the source of their beliefs. Weber's interest is always in social phenomena, behavior that is organized through communities and their shared institutions and concepts. Tyler's religion, as I say, could be practiced alone. Weber's involves essentially doing things together. But whereas in the Protestant ethic he had leaped immediately into the phenomena by giving us Franklin as a provisional illustration, here, in this more systematic work, his aim is to sketch, like Tyler, a framework within which all the religions of the world can eventually be accommodated. And it's remarkably reminiscent, to begin with, of Tyler's. He starts, for example, like Tyler, with the most basic forms of religion, and even describes them as Urwüchsigen, which is one of the natural translations from German of primitive. And he asserts, like Tyler, that they are oriented to this world. Religion begins, for both of them, with getting things done in the here and now, not in a search for some hoped-for life beyond. And he, too, explains the shape of later religious forms through their development from earlier ones, following a method that is historical, if not exactly evolutionary. Weber wants to start with Verstehen, with understanding the ideas that guide religious behavior. So is there a concept that identifies something in the mental lives of religious adherents around the globe that underlies their behavior and that will provide a key to understanding this particular type of social behavior? Weber's answer here, his famous answer, is that there is, and he calls it charisma. Charisma began, of course, as a technical term in Jewish and Christian thought, referring to the gifts of God's charis, his grace, as in St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, where he lists them: wisdom, knowledge, faith, the gifts of healing, miracles, prophecy, the discerning of spirits, and a capacity to speak and understand many languages, glossolalia. Weber took this technical religious idea and applied it to special powers that could be found in certain particular objects and people. Charisma had played a central role in the political sociology that precedes the sociology of religion in the overall argument of economy and society. There, it refers to one of the three kinds of political authority, alongside the rational and the traditional. Charismatic authority is associated, he says, with either the extraordinary devotion to holiness, or the heroic power, or the exemplary character of people, and the commands they reveal or issue. But this idea is clearly a metaphorical extension of the application to the compelling, magically underwritten authority of prophets and heroes. To understand even its application to politics, then, we need to start with the ideal type of charisma which is on display in religion and in magic. When he first introduces the idea in the sociology of religion, Weber says simply that those who believe in magic acknowledge the geringeren Alltäglichkeit, the lesser ordinariness, funny way of putting it, of things like a stone that is used as a fetish, or of those people who can achieve ecstatic states and through them produce meteorological, therapeutic, divinatory, or telepathic effects. Extraordinary powers like these, he says, have been given such special names as mana in Polynesia, orenda among the Iroquois, and the Iranian maga, from which magic. And Weber proposes to use the word charisma for all these powers. His proposal is that wherever you have magic and religion, you have some such concept in the thought of those who practice them. Charisma comes in two kinds. One primary form of charisma is a natural ability which cannot be acquired, but the other sort of charisma can be produced in people and in things by artificial means, though only if they've already have the germ of them inside them, a germ that can be awakened, for example, by ascetic practices. The special powers of charisma can be found, say, in icons or statues of saints in contemporary folk religion in Europe, which operate in what Weber called a naturalistic, so-called pre-animistic way. Well, having read Tyler, we know that he means that these powers are supposed to work without imagining the presence in the charismatic object, the icon or the statue, of spiritual beings. That's why, he says, the church has not been able to deter peasants in southern Europe from spitting on a saint's statue if, despite the customary manipulations, the desired result does not occur. It is the magical icon, not the saint, a power, not a person, that is being assaulted. So even though the process here is pre-animistic, that doesn't require belief in spirits directly, Weber goes on immediately, this is part of his, the way he assembles ideal types is sort of sometimes paradoxical. Weber goes on immediately to say that even in these cases, they have imagined something behind the charismatically endowed natural objects, artifacts, animals, and human beings, concealed and somewhat determining their behavior, the belief in spirits, what he calls der Geisterglaube. If we stopped here, we might think that Weber's understanding of religion returns to Tyler's here, even though Weber doesn't actually mention Tyler's name. But Weber gives an account of his spirits that is clear enough to see that it is different from Tyler's. In their basic form, the spirits are not souls or demons or gods, but, quote, something undefined, material yet invisible, impersonal and yet imagined as equipped with a kind of will, giving the concrete object its specific efficacy. And as we'll see more clearly later, Weber does not see the basic intellectual strategy of belief in spirits as the projection of the human soul and with it an anthropomorphic agency into the world. So he disagrees with Tyler's central claim. So this is not what I called last time the full intentional strategy. So Weber starts in a different place, with charisma and with spirits less like us, and as we shall now see, his focus on social behavior takes him swiftly in a very different direction from Tyler. Weber thinks belief in charisma develops first in societies where magical powers are found in people with special qualifications, people who belong to what he says is the oldest of vocations, using the word that Luther had used, Beruf, which he calls Zauberer, magicians, people who do magic. These professionals are permanently possessed of charisma. By profession, they are always capable of achieving ecstasy, which is the distinctive human state that both mediates and represents charisma. Ecstasy is something different from what Weber calls the rational magic with which he begins, which is the pre-animist, naturalistic manipulation of objects with special powers. And it's available to laymen only within the social form that he calls the orgy, which is the primitive form of religious community. The model Weber has in mind here is the Dionysian mystery cults, in which initiates engaged in collective secret practices, the orgia, which led to ecstatic experience, to reverie, rapture, hallucination, possession, and every kind of enchantment. The layman can achieve ecstasy through intoxication with alcohol, tobacco, or narcotics, or through music and dance. But the professional magician knows how to manage the distinctive psychological state the orgy induces. Weber thinks belief in the soul as something distinct from the body originates in this orgiastic experience, as the idea of what it is that leaves the body in ecstasy, but also in dreams and fainting and death, something that can also be found behind, near, or in natural objects. Gradually, over time, spirits come to be seen as normally invisible beings, governed by laws of their own, not living in or possessing objects, but symbolized by them. So the idea of the human spirit, the soul, grows out of a religious practice, the orgy, rather than antedating and explaining it, as in Tyler. Though these spirits inhabit people and things, they are not yet fully personal. They don't necessarily have names. Indeed, they may not endure beyond their operation in a single event. So unlike Tyler's spirits, Weber's souls begin as something more like impersonal forces, albeit with wills, than people. Drawing on a wide range, on material from a wide range of societies, Weber finds belief in a multiplicity of souls, as I said last time, was traditional in Ashanti, where I grew up. There's one soul that leaves somebody's body in dreams, another that abandons her in ecstasy, or travels as her shadow, or that survives as her ghost, or returns to her family with messages from the afterlife. But a religion need not involve belief in a separate soul at all, Weber says, since at least some forms of Buddhism, for example, reject this idea, as do some of the other, what Weber calls, religions of salvation. Eventually, though, some souls do become enduring personalities bearing the names of deified heroes, say, and then we have gods. But this isn't really the significant distinction. What matters is that religion gives a role not just to things and events that exist and happen, but also to things that have a meaning beyond themselves. Magic becomes, he wrote, a symbolic activity. Now, Tyler had used the word symbol a few dozen times in primitive culture, and like any reasonable observer, he noticed that religious acts are often, in some sense, symbolic. But it didn't occur to him to see symbolism as central to religion, as Weber clearly does, or to insist on the most obvious reason why this must be so, even on an account that focuses simply on the animist belief in spirits. For if these spirits behind the world are indeed like persons, we will need to communicate with them. That requires working, Weber says, through means that speak to a spirit or a soul, something, therefore, that has meaning through symbols. Weber saw this would have important consequences. One was what he called the stereotyping of religious behavior. The first and fundamental effect of religious conceptions on the conduct of life and on the economy is generally stereotyping. Every alteration of practice, which is somehow administered under the protection of supersensible powers, can affect the interests of spirits and gods. Thus, religion adds powerful obstacles to the natural uncertainties and inhibitions of every innovator. The sacred is the intrinsically unalterable. The point is exemplified in speech. If I want to communicate effectively, I must use words in familiar ways. As with my fellow humans, especially with powerful ones, so with spirits, it's important to address them in ways that express not just my wishes, but also my respect. Because spirits and gods can be hard to perceive, I don't have the feedback from them in their faces and expressions that would allow me to keep track of whether I am getting through. And so, once I find a form of words and a performance that works, I will stick to it. There's no feedback for me to wait for. For Weber, a symbolic act has two dimensions. It has a form, which is often highly stylized or stereotyped, and it has its meaning. The meaning belongs to the world of the practitioner, so that what the acts mean, they mean for him or for her. While the term charisma belongs to Weber's theoretical vocabulary, the idea that some people and objects have a special power, whether they call it mana or arenda, or say, like my Asante ancestors, that something is sasa, that belongs to the religious adherence conceptual world. Weber thinks religion starts with the conviction that some people and things have extraordinary powers derived from the presence of a spirit, which is something endowed with a kind of will, and that they have a vocabulary to discuss these powers, they themselves, not just Weber. Over time in history, however, as the spirits develop personality and become gods, they are associated with various social groups for which they have a special concern and over which they exercise a special authority. But the important distinction here is not Tyler's distinction between gods, which are anthropomorphic or aristocratic, and other lesser spirits, but rather it's a distinction in the behavior with which we relate to them. It's the social forms through which the gods are addressed that distinguish them from the spirits. Quote, "One can distinguish those forms of interaction with the supersensible powers which express themselves in prayer, sacrifice, and worship, as religion and cult, from magic, which involves magical compulsion, and accordingly designate as gods those beings that are religiously worshipped and prayed to, and as demons, those which are magically compelled or bound with spells." So it's not really what they are, it's what you do with them that distinguishes gods from demons and a religion from magic. The differentiation in social forms is connected with the distinction that Weber makes between the magicians, the Zauberer, and priests. The Zauberer are the earliest of the charismatic professionals, and he began with them. But the core difference is that magicians work alone, while priests are part of a profession operating a continuously operating cult. That's his phrase. Ein kontinuierlicher Kultusbetrieb. Such continuously operating cults and their functionaries, the priests, are central to social organization. Wherever a group or association does not appear to be the personal power position of a single power holder, but is a true union, it needs to have its own god, Weber says. Now, this unqualified statement is, like most of his unqualified statements, immediately qualified. For though a household is such a true union, for example, and normally does have its ancestral gods, these can be suppressed entirely as the result of the dominance of the priests of a national deity, as happened, according to Weber, in ancient Judaism. In fact, the process by which Yahweh supplanted the household gods of the Israelites is part of a wider pattern in which the domination of one association over another, in this case, the cult of Yahweh over the family, is reflected in theological terms, both at home and abroad. As a general rule, he writes, one's victory was the victory of one's god over the weaker god of the stranger, and the Greek polis exemplified a corollary of this pattern. So long as these city-states remained with distinct political identities, they were going to have distinct civic gods, even though they knew about each other's gods. Weber believed that human societies displayed a tendency, not a rigid law of development, but an ideal typical pattern, towards what he called rationalization. The word rationalisierung occurs more than 150 times in economy and society, and the word rationality, occurs almost as often. That's called digital humanities. This is in part because Weber uses the word to cover at least four processes: the systematization of belief, an increasing commitment to means-end calculation, instrumental rationality, a decline in appeal to mysterious incalculable forces, disenchantment, Entzauberung, and the growth of value rationality, which entails an increasing focus on maximizing a narrow range of personal goals. Now, all these processes occur in his account of the development of a religion. And priests are important for the systematization, both of theology and of a religious ethics. And by ethics, he means not the norms that govern our treatment of one another, but all, not just those norms, but all the norms of behavior, including established rituals and the customary forms of proper behavior. Tyler had argued that early religion was not much concerned with ethics, you'll recall. Weber agreed, but argued that the gods became increasingly involved in making ethical demands in parallel with the processes that led to the increasing rationalization of norms as social organization became more complex. With the rise of peaceful, law-governed states, the growth of a scientific understanding of the natural world, and the increased regimentation of human interactions through conventional rules, and a growing dependence in economic activity of reliance on the word of others, people became more dependent on expectations based on personal attachment to what he calls a cosmos of obligations, which makes their behavior predictable. Now, religions not only supported the moral norms necessary for the coordination of social and economic life, they generated their own forms of obligation, ritual practices whose point for the actor is that they are demanded by a god. Religion was not just the pursuit of ends given outside it, as it was for Tyler. Now, it becomes a source of ends itself. Weber's examples are almost all drawn from Eurasia and involve the traditions of literate societies whose religions centrally involve sacred writings: the Abrahamic religions, Zoroastrianism, Hinduism and Buddhism, and Confucianism and Taoism. Weber's fascinating discussions of prophecy or of the diverse road to salvation in Buddhism and various Abrahamic traditions explore different equilibria between ethics and theology, which depend on various ways of relating to the gods. But precisely because, as he promised at the start, the focus is on forms of social behavior, his explanatory attention is directed almost always towards showing how different combinations of ethics and theology, along with elements of magic, which never totally disappears, are associated with a variety of economic and political institutions, as of course he had sought to show in the work on the Protestant ethic and the spirit of capitalism. The interest in priests, for example, derives in part from the fact that as the functionaries of an institution, they tend to participate in the kind of rationalization that, as I said, Weber sees as the driving force of history. Priests rationalize both theology and ethics, both religious theory and practice. They make them both more systematic and coherent and more formal. Literacy is hugely important here for reasons Weber, I think, doesn't sufficiently acknowledge in the sociology of religion. For writing is one of the great technologies of rationalization, permitting the maintenance of a kind of consistency that is essentially impossible in oral cultures. It's also what makes possible the development of the sort of extended bureaucracy that is exemplified in priesthoods going back to the time of the pharaohs, in exactly the way that marks for Weber the contrast between magician and priest, and so the distinction between magic and religion. Religion is what happens when charisma becomes the institutional prerogative of the professional class. There is no need to worry about the distinction between monotheism and polytheism. Indeed, in the most rarefied forms of Buddhism, as Weber understands them, there is no need for gods or for the soul. There is just the management of charisma. So without the concept of charisma, Weber's formal understanding of religion would be just the very belief in spirits that defined Tyler's animism. If he's got something new, it has to be found in charisma. So charisma has a lot of work to do. And yet, if one returns to his introduction of the concept, it is at least as obscure as Tyler's account of spirits. Charisma, recall, was introduced simply as involving außer alltäglichen Kräfte, powers outside the everyday. But in many societies, the sort of magic Weber discusses, the appeal by the Catholic saint, the Catholic patron, peasant to the icon of the saint, that's a literally an everyday affair. This is not a power outside the everyday. What is distinctive about magic isn't its infrequency, but the kind of causality it involves, the appeal to hidden powers associated with something like a will. And though Weber insists that this doesn't yet need to entail belief in spirits, the idea of a will does involve the production into the world of an aspect of our human psychology. The difference between Tyler and Weber, then, is something like this. Religion, for Weber, need not involve the full intentional strategy. Indeed, as we saw, Weber believes that the idea of the soul is the product, not the source, of religious practices. It derives from the experience of ecstasy in the orgy. And as we also saw, the distinction between magic and religion, for Weber, is a distinction in the social functions of magicians and priests. It's the social role of the person with the extraordinary powers. For Tyler, it is the distinction between seeing causality where there is none, which is magic, and full-fledged belief in agency, which is religion. Tyler, Weber, and Durkheim, to whom I turn now, offer an almost comical confirmation of national stereotypes. Tyler, the commonsensical Englishman, Weber, the German with his opaque profundities, Durkheim seeking in the proper Gallic fashion to construct a language of gleaming Cartesian clarity. In the introduction of Les formes élémentaires de la vie religieuse, the French philosopher-sociologist lays out a series of propositions that aim to introduce, by the end of the chapter, a formal definition of religion. He goes on then to defend it by showing how his definition allows us, unlike some other theories, including Tyler's, which he argues against explicitly at some length, that he goes on to show how his theory makes sense of the detailed ethnography of Australian Aboriginal totemism. We start here because this is the most primitive religion, in the sense, he says, that it is found in the society with the simplest form of organization, and that none of its features need explaining as a result of earlier religions. It's where religion begins. Hence, the subtitle of the original French edition is Le Système Totémique en Australie, the totemic system in Australia. Modern publishers don't put that in there because it'll put people off. But Durkheim's aim was to give an account ready for use in describing the religions of the present and of the future. In religion, he says in the book's conclusion, there is, quote, something eternal that is destined to survive all the forms it has taken in the past. Very early on, Durkheim establishes one of his central assumptions. Whatever they are, if religions survive for long periods as social institutions, they must have got something right. It is, he tells us, an essential postulate of sociology that a human institution cannot be based on error and lies. If it did, it could not survive. There are, therefore, at bottom, no religions that are false. Well, this tells us immediately something about Weber's conception of religions. They are, or at the very least, they must include the kinds of things that can have a truth value. And the obvious candidate for the possession of truth values are propositions, the things we assert and believe. Durkheim's postulate is obviously prima facie extremely surprising, since many familiar claims made in the name of one religion seem to be inconsistent with the claims made by others. Christianity denies and Islam asserts that Muhammad is a prophet and Christ is not. How can both be true? That would only be a problem, though, if Durkheim had claimed not that religions must be true, but that every claim made in the name of a religion must be true. And that he would certainly have denied. Still, one thing that almost everyone in the world believes is that most religions are wrong about something really important. Polytheists, like my Asante ancestors, think monotheists, like Jews, and atheists, like Buddhists, are mistaken. They all pay the others the courtesy of thinking the same about them. In what sense can they all nevertheless be true? Well, perhaps because whatever is true in them, it's not their assertions or beliefs. And in fact, the religious propositions that are true for Durkheim are not the assertions and beliefs of the adherents. Indeed, despite his initial claim, Durkheim, unlike Tyler and Weber, sees the literal meaning of religious claims as one of the least important aspects of their role in explaining social behavior. We can only understand this view if we start with what Durkheim thinks is distinctive of religious belief. The answer is superficially straightforward. Religious beliefs in societies, both simple and complex, are in some sense about the division of ideas and of things into two classes, which he calls the sacred and the profane. Quote, beliefs, myths, dogmas, legends are representations or systems of representations that express the nature of sacred things, the virtues and the powers that are attributed to them, their history, their relations with one another, and with profane things. Religion contains two kinds of phenomena, though, of which belief is only one. The other is ritual, behavior governed by the rules that prescribe how one should relate to sacred things. So the religious beliefs are about sacred things, and rituals are governed by rules that tell you how you should relate to sacred things. Now, the sacred is to Durkheim what charisma was to Weber. It is the key to unlocking the door to religion. And indeed, mana, orenda, and magic all figure as examples of the sacred for Durkheim, as they did for charisma for Weber. Durkheim is keen to point out that his theory explains why you can count Buddhism as a religion, even though it has no soul and no gods, because, he says, the four sacred truths are sacred, and so therefore are the practices that derive from them, which are therefore instances of ritual. But it's also crucial to Durkheim's view that these beliefs and rituals play a role in binding those who share them into the moral community that he called a church. The first chapter of Les Formes Élémentaires offers a well-known definition. A religion is a unified system of beliefs and practices in relation to sacred things, which is to say, forbidden, beliefs and practices that unite all those who adhere to them into the same moral community called a church. And in the chapter's last sentence, he insists that in showing that the concept of religion is inseparable from the idea of a church, he has intimated that religion has to be something profoundly collective. Well, couldn't Weber say that the sacred is just another word for charisma? Charisma is what makes objects and people sacred. And doesn't Durkheim, like Weber, think that the ideal type of a religion involves a cultic institution, a church? Of course, Durkheim's cults, his churches, need no organized bureaucracy, so there can be churches for Durkheim without priests. Indeed, the aboriginal totemism Durkheim presents us with as his paradigm of primitive religion is the practice largely of ordinary people who have profane lives away from the special places and times where they experience the ecstasy of their collective religious life. But both these men believed that real religion involves institutions for shared ritual activity. Durkheim's official explanation of what the sacred is runs as follows. Sacred things are those that are protected and isolated by prohibitions. Profane ones, those to which these prohibitions apply, the latter having to keep their distance from the former. Religious beliefs express the nature of sacred things and the relations they enter into, whether with each other or with profane things. So religious rituals are forms of behavior governed by the rules that determine how human beings should behave in relation to the sacred, thus understood. Durkheim's intellectual ingenuity is displayed in the account he offers of Australian totemism as his paradigm of early religion, understood this way. The essence of totemism is the identification of the clan, a social group, with a plant or animal, the totem, and the development of ritual practices around an emblem of that organism, which becomes the most sacred kind of object. So in the case of North American Indians, the totem pole is the emblem of the organism that is the identified with this clan. So if my clan is the clan of the kangaroo, then abstract symbolic representations of kangaroos carved on a piece of wood are for me and the members of my clan the most sacred of objects, hemmed about with prohibitions. Indeed, Durkheim says at one point that the totem is this emblem, first and foremost. That is, the totem pole is the totem. Next most sacred will be kangaroos themselves and other members of the clan, because they are kangaroos too. And in certain contexts, they will even engage in kangaroo-like behavior. Durkheim's most complete explanation of the relations between the emblems of the totem, the clan, and the clan animal is this. Totemism is the religion not of such and such animals, or such and such people, or such and such emblems, but of a sort of anonymous and impersonal force that is to be found in each of these entities, without, however, being totally identical with any of them. None of them possesses that force totally, and all participate in it. Individuals die, generations pass, and are replaced with others, but this force remains forever real, living, and like itself. To use the word in a very broad sense, the force is the god that each totemic cult worships. And all these things are surrounded with prohibitions, in essence, he says, because contact with this force, this god, poses dangers for those not specifically prepared for it. In fact, Durkheim likens this force to electricity, dangerous to handle, pervasive, powerful. Durkheim thinks these ideas originated in a special kind of social experience, not unlike Weber's orgy, in which the Aborigines gather together in what they called a corroboree to dance and sing together. In the course of this rite, they experienced what Durkheim called a collective effervescence, the sort of excitement generated, he says, in periods of revolutionary collective action. He offers the Crusades and the French Revolution as examples. An energy that enhances the individual power of those who participate in it. It is, he says, out of these contexts of social effervescence that the religious idea seems to appear. That is, the idea of this force that connects the clan and the clan animal and the totem. So what the Aborigines are responding to here, he says, is the experience of society, of social union. And it's in this sense that religion is about society. It's a response to the social fact. Durkheim claims that our primitive ancestors discovered religion through this religious social activity, and that Weber says that what they imagined there was the human soul. The formal definition with which Durkheim had begun left out a crucial element of his theory of religion then. Sacred objects represent or symbolize social facts. Indeed, though he doesn't put it exactly this way, we can say that that is why they are sacred. They're sacred because of the way they're connected with society. One major difference, however, between Weber and Durkheim is over the role of symbolism. For Durkheim, what religious beliefs and practices express, their symbolic content, is the deep truth of our social relations, our profound dependence, not on something outside the human world, but on our own societies. But though they express this dependence, they are not understood by the practitioners to do so. For Weber, on the other hand, symbolism communicates, however obscurely, the thoughts of believers. Durkheim would have protested against Weber, as he did against Tyler, that they thought religion was mostly untrue. But Durkheim makes the truth of religion something that the religious do not know. That the beliefs of the religious are not literally true is something about which all of them agree. In the next lecture, I'll show how the preoccupation of the three founding fathers of modern social science, including their rejection of religious truths, persist in some recent work in the evolutionary psychology of religion, published often not in social science journals, but in journals of theoretical biology. I'll go on to argue that there's a reason why our theories have not converged on an answer to the question, what for social science is a religion, with which I began. And at the end, I'll offer some conclusions about what this means for the scientific study of religion. Thank you very much. Yeah, eventually. But I think not very eventually. Soonish, I believe. Good. Though I don't really have the authority to say that, but I believe it's true.
So I'm curious. Is this on?
Yeah.
Okay. And the question occurred to me when you were talking about Weber and the sociology of religion, but I could extend it to Durkheim and Tyler. And it's this, in considering the development of religion, did they consider at all mystery cults, such as the Eleusinian mysteries or Isis and Osiris? And did they also give consideration to the role of psychoactive plants?
Well, the answer to the first question is yes. Especially, Weber does talk about Egypt. I think his model of the orgy is sort of Dionysian stuff, but he knew about the other Greek mystery religions, and he would have said that they too demonstrated the importance of charisma as a sort of force. But you also asked one other thing about, what was it?
I was wondering, I extend that to Durkheim or Tyler.
Yes. Yes. I mean, I think they would have, well, first of all, even if they hadn't, they would have, of course, claimed that their theory fitted those cases very nicely. And because they, because Tyler's interested in primitive, what he calls primitive culture, the earliest forms, he doesn't say a lot about the cases that interested Weber the most, which were the cases where you have elaborate social institutions and priesthoods and you know, regular cult. He's interested more in something like what Durkheim's interested in totemism, which is there are no priests among the Aborigines. They come together from time to time into this social practice of the corroboree, but it doesn't happen every week. You know, it may correspond to certain cycles in nature, but it doesn't happen with great regularity. And most of their lives are profane, Durkheim thinks. Now Tyler wouldn't have agreed with that. Tyler thinks that if you're in primitive religion, people are thinking about spirits all the time. Everything they do is driven by the thought, not just human spirits, but non-human spirits, all the time. That everything they do is hemmed about by the thought that there might be some spirit that's governed whatever the object is you're dealing with, and that will shape how you should behave in response to it. I think they would all have... Weber does talk about a lot of the Greek and he certainly, I've read him mentioning the Egyptian cases. And as I say, I think each of them, I don't think Tyler's very interested in the socially complex religions. Weber definitely is. And most of the sociology of religion is taken up with discussing really a small class of what we think of as world religions and their different views of salvation, which I didn't talk about. But
hey, thank you.
Two quick questions. It's interesting the way in which a paradigm case plays an important role for Durkheim, right? The Aussie Aborigines. Is there anything like that going on, do you think, in Weber? And the other question I have is, what are the chief critiques that Durkheim levels against Tyler?
Well, first of all, you don't really need spirits to have the sacred, because the key thing is the idea of this thing that you're not... your behavior in relation to which has to be very careful because it's got this sort of power, but it doesn't have to be a personal power. And he thinks that you've got, as it were, all you need for real religion, and that the idea of the human soul and so on, actually that all comes as a result of these religious practices, whereas Tyler thinks that it explains them, and he disagrees with him very much about that. I think he also, he makes a criticism of Tyler that I think is just completely unfair. He says, look, as I've shown, religion is true, but Tyler thinks it's false. But the sense in which Durkheim thinks religion is true is the sense in which, the sense in which Tyler thinks religion is false is the sense in which Durkheim thinks religion is false. Namely, you don't have to believe in the spirits to use this theory to explain things. You don't appeal to the spirits. Tyler doesn't appeal mostly. with rare exceptions, Tyler does not appeal to the reality of spirits in order to explain anything. He just appeals to belief in them, and the thing you're explaining is why people who believe this stuff would do what they do. Because the truth of religion for Durkheim is what it says about the dependence of the individual on the social, which he takes to be correct. He takes to be the reason why religion persists, why it survives, is because it does two things. It correctly represents our dependence upon the social group, and it reinforces our commitment to that group. It helps us do the sacrificial things, not in terms of sacrificing to gods, but in terms of sacrificing for one another. I mean, it's an important fact about Dreyfus, it's an important fact about Durkheim, that this stuff is written in the Dreyfus era. In fact, his wife's maiden name was Dreyfus, though they were not related. And he's really interested in developing an understanding of religion that will allow a modern person who does not believe in spirits, nevertheless, to think that there's a truth in claims, in this case made by nationalism, about the profound dependence of people on their communities of which they are members. And so he's very much wanting to hold on to this kind of rather rational understanding of what is in its lived form not a very rational thing, a thing that is a response to the effervescence, as he says, of our most intense social interactions with one another, our most intense participation in large group activities, the activities of the crowd in the revolution, the French Revolution, the madness of crowds, as it were. He wants to see that as continuous with you know, historic religious practices and as reflecting in the way that they did the truth, the ethical truth that we must be willing to sacrifice for one another, for society, and the sociological truth that we are profoundly dependent upon social. And none of that is visible in Tyler. So he makes, as I say, I mean, I was at one point going to sort of go through the criticisms, but it seemed to me a lot of them were like the one about the truth thing, not really very fair. that if Tyler had been around, he could have, he was around, but I don't know what he said. He was very old by that point. But it's worth, I mean, see, Weber doesn't say anything about Tyler. I think it's worth looking at. I think that Durkheim's critiques of Tyler help you to understand what Durkheim is saying, as it were, and where he thinks he differs from Tyler. They're pretty focused. It's about sort of 10 pages in a couple of places.
Pardon me if you raised this in the last lecture, which I was unable to attend, but did Durkheim and Tyler address the so-called axial age hypothesis? Sure. I know, of course, Weber has a discussion about it, and did they recognize that? And if they didn't, is there something about their approach which made them less susceptible, less right. sensitive to this idea?
So, I think that Durkheim and Tyler are more evolutionist than Weber. And so, what that means for Tyler is that he really does think that the sort of what must lie at the base of all the religious traditions is this fundamental thing. Then stuff gets overlaid on it, and maybe at the end you can have Buddhism where the spirits have disappeared. But it's sort of overlaid, and all comes from the operation of a normal human psychological disposition, this projection of intentionality, and so. And so, he's, in other words, But if you, that's your view, you won't be interested in questions of diffusion. Because you will think that what, I'll talk about this more next time, but you will think that what accounts for the similarities is the operation of psychological laws on human nature. And it won't, so you will predict that human beings will do the same things everywhere without any need to discuss questions of diffusion. Nevertheless, of course, you know, Weber wrote about all the axial age, the main axial age figures, and Durkheim doesn't say, I don't recall anything much in Durkheim. I mean, they all mention Buddhism and Confucianism, which I think of as sort of the hard cases for a view that's designed for the Abrahamic religions. But not very much in Durkheim, at least not in the elementary forms. Whereas Weber mentions Confucianism a lot, which is that's a bit of a puzzle, I think, because he doesn't think it's a religion. So why is he talking about it all the time? I mean, he thinks that religion in China is Taoism. Now, just making that very distinction is itself something that's motivated by a theory, I think. That's a rambling answer, but I think I said that thing about Tyler. Durkheim, I think, is like Tyler in that respect. He thinks that once you've got the basic thing, and that it's sort of a natural thing that evolves out of the thing that any early society would do, you don't have to answer the question why there are these similarities across cases by appeal to any notion of connection among them. Now, I imagine, they don't talk about this explicitly, but I imagine that Durkheim thought that the way Aborigines lived was the way our ancestors lived long before the Axial Age, I suspect. I mean, I think one of the sort of ethnographic difficulties about all of these people is that they misunderstand the character of the cultures of the societies that they think of as primitive today. They think that they are, as it were, carrying on after 10,000 years, something that our ancestors did 10,000 years ago. That's what makes them primitive there. Or, as I said, one of the German translations is of primitive culture is the beginnings of culture. Now, this is sort of nonsense. All human cultures live in history. They have the form they do as a result of people having done things and changed things, forgotten things, remembered things, written things down and not written things, you know, all that. So I think that it's important, you know, as it were, to have if you have a contemporary, responsible anthropological view, to get that out of the way. Nevertheless, I mean, it isn't so implausible that... I'm going to talk about this next time a little bit, so maybe I'll stop. I mean, there are... the form of the similarities that they identified across the whole world is rather surprising. And so there is a genuine puzzle, I think, which diffusionism aims to answer about why... So just to give you an example, which I'll talk about next time. There are gods pretty much like Odin and Loki among the Yoruba. And there's a god who's associated with thunder and iron, like Thor. It's not very likely that this is the result. I mean, those places are a long way apart, historically and geographically, before the aeroplane. Durkheim's two examples of totemism are Iroquois and Aborigine. That's about as far apart as you can get in the human range, right? Because the Aborigines left and went that way and arrived 35,000 years ago in Australia. And wherever the North American Indians came from, they must have come out of Asia somewhere. And more recently than that. And so, you know, the genetic evidence is that they're very, very disconnected from each other historically, that they haven't had interaction for tens of thousands of years. So it would be very surprising, I think, if the explanation... So it's a puzzle, how to explain it. And one possibility is just, well, their explanation. This is a deep feature of the way we are, so it's the way we are before complex societies develop. It's the way we are everywhere. That was their explanation. Because of the stuff about the axial age, Weber can believe, at least about the main traditions that he's interested in, that they do have connections with each other, and that so there's a partly diffusionist possible thing. And also they have writing. And also they really did connect with each other, actually. So he's right about that. Hi.
Moss a lot to say about sacrifice and takes on sort of Durkheim's project much further. So I'm wondering if there's something comparable to be said about sacrifice, especially with a relationship to magic and science in Tyler, Durkheim, and Weber. Is there some sort of a comparable engagement with the idea of sacrifice as far as both magic and religion are concerned for these three thinkers?
Tyler's focus in his discussion of sacrifice, which exists, is on propitiation. So sacrifice is essentially doing something for a god in return for the hope that the god will do something for you. That's what sacrifice is. In Durkheim, the focus is on the ways in which religious forms lead people to do things that are costly for them, but good for society. So the pro-social things. So sacrifice there is really not about getting something for me. It's about being willing to get something for the social good. So it's a completely different way of thinking about what sacrifice is. There's another possible way of thinking about sacrifice, which is neither of those, which is the thought of sacrifice as the expression of respect, right? Not for the gods. So it's Tylorian in that the focus is on the spirits, but it's un-Tylorian in being non-instrumental. It's part of our relationship with the gods that we give them sacrifice. And that's the point of it. It's not to get them to do anything. It's not a tit for tat. We're not giving them something. I mean, we don't have anything that they really need. So they have, those two have very different ideas. I'm trying to think, I mean, I don't remember well enough what Weber says about sacrifice to fit him into the picture. But those two are very interesting because I think of them as, you know, almost totally opposed in their view of... So you mentioned Moss. Tyler sees sacrifice as essentially a form of gift, and he understands it in a very instrumental way, which, of course, Moss doesn't. But, So one could do, maybe I will, a chapter on these different theories of sacrifice and what they tell you about how they are thinking about religion. Sacrifice is, as I say, crucial to Durkheim because the truth in religion is essentially that we need sometimes to sacrifice ourselves for the group. That is the, if you want to know what the truth is, that he thinks that all religions fundamentally express. And that means that you can have that truth embodied in rituals and practices of nationalism. You don't need gods in the modern period. And so, as I say, you know, as a French Jew in the period of the First World War, all these questions about nationalism and identification are very, very much part of his life and what he's thinking about.
This is our last question.
Thank you very much for another great talk. I was really interested in the Durkheimian methodology, Durkheim methodology, and starting kind of with the simplest case, it seems very reasonable. It's going to allow you to kind of investigate the phenomenon that you're interested in, kind of its purity, and kind of isolate the things that the phenomenon itself is doing. And then on the other hand, there seem to be some dangers with the methodology. So suppose we wanted to understand the nature of mathematics, we wouldn't go to the most primitive form of mathematics. We would study actually the most developed form of mathematics. or suppose that we wanted to understand the nature of democracy, we wouldn't go to the simplest form of government, because that might lead us to think, or at least, I mean, I suppose if you have realist intuitions, realist in the political science sense, then you might think, well, if you study that way, you're going to see that everything's relations of power, brute force. So I was wondering if sort of Durkheim was aware of sort of these dangers of starting with the simplest case, and whether he thought that there was something specific about religion that made it better to study this way than like mathematics.
So the approach is just to separate out Weber from Durkheim and Tyler in relation to this question. I would say Weber is the one who's least convinced that the way we get to understand the advanced religions is by finding a core in the ancient stuff. They grow out of the ancient stuff. Everybody thinks that, all three of them. But precisely because, I think I quoted him saying, we're not interested in essences. Precisely because of that, the role of the historical explanation is that it's just, as it were, one thing grows out of another. It's not that there's some persisting essence that passes through all the stages that explains that they're all the same thing. Tyler definitely is an essentialist of that sort. He does think that the reason why we can see religion at its clearest in primitive cultures is because it's sort of unencumbered, it's in essence unencumbered by accretions. Once it's there, this spiritual belief stuff, then other things can be laid on top of it. But the thing that makes them all religions is this thing that was there in its clearest in the earliest cases. Now, so I think that's where I think sort of Weber and Tyler are on this. Durkheim is the only one who actually offers a definition, who says what a religion is. So I guess he's committed to the view that there is a correct answer to the sort of the essence, there's a nominal essence anyway for religions. But, and I suppose he did think that looking at what he, so at the beginning of the elementary forms, he says that he's picked this case because it is a case where the society is simple, and B, there's no evidence that anything about their religious life needs to be explained by appeal to anything earlier. So it's a beginning, in some sense. That does sort of suggest that you think that something like Tyler, that if you sort of clear away the accretions of later ages and go back to the start, you'll see what the essence is. As you know, because we talked last night, I think this is a bad idea. I think it's the wrong way to think about these social objects, that they should, I don't think any form of essentialism, any form of the view that says that they have to start, you have to have something present at the start that is then always there forever in order for the thing to be that, the thing that it is, in this case, a religion. I think that's just a mistake about, the best way to think about social ontology. All three of them, Weber less than the other two, in their focus on the primitive, and then the claim that having understood the primitive, we basically understood religion, they do seem to be thinking in a way that makes most sense if you have some kind of essentialist picture.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Please join us at the reception.